Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Quantum Curators and the Enemy Within by Eva St. Narrated by Alex Wyndham and Lucy Rayner. 1. Julius. My name is Julius Strathclyde, and I might be dead. This is my story. I waded through the freezing water. People surged past me crying. Others grabbed my arm, demanding to know if the way ahead was blocked. Their voices bounced weirdly off the rising water levels and flock-lined corridors. An old lady in a flimsy pink gown held a small lapdog aloft, a fur stole wrapped around the top of them in some futile attempt to stay warm in the icy water. I removed my dinner jacket and draped it over her shoulder, tucking the stole underneath. The dog snapped at me, but she scolded it and pleaded with me to help. As we made our way to the outer deck, I remembered my mission. I wasn't here to save people, I was here to save a book. Her bony fingers dug into me, begging me not to abandon her. I had to harden my resolve to ignore her cries as I turned and fought against the tide of the other first-class passengers struggling through the water. This was the hardest aspect of any mission, not the potential threat to life and limb, but ignoring the suffering of those around me. A man shoved me out of his way, ushering his wife and children along. Clearly he had mistaken me for staff. He looked the sort. Or maybe I was doing him a disservice and he was panicking. Personally, I thought it was the former. As our eyes caught, he frowned. Perhaps he didn't like my expression. Here we were on the Titanic as it began to sink, and he was putting himself first. I struggled past the crowd until their voices fell away and the corridors emptied. As I walked through the water, I counted off the doors until I reached my destination. 12, 13, 14. I was getting closer to my goal when the floor shuddered and I felt the boat tilt further. I could hear distant screams and shouts. Somewhere a violin was playing, but here in this corridor, all was quiet. Just strange mechanical groans echoing along the structure, the water muffling everything else. The leather soles of my shoes slipped on the carpet, and I had to grab onto the balustrade. My arm plunged into the water, and I could see goose flesh skin through my sopping sleeve. As I got to cabin 15, I tried the door, but ridiculously it was locked. Who, whilst fleeing for their life on a sinking ship, locks the door? I went to pull out my lockpicks and realized with horror that they were nice and safe in my jacket pocket, which was now on its way to the lifeboat, draped over the shoulder of a little old lady and her pet dog. "Hello, cadet. Do you need assistance?" I jumped. The disembodied voice of the AI support chirped in my ear. No, I did not need any assistance. "Disengage." "Are you sure about that, cadet? You appear to be struggling." "Great, mocked by a computer. Disengage now." Feeling furious with myself, I saw I would have to open the door with brute force. I would solve this problem myself and not rely on the wrist brace. Running at the door wouldn't work, as the water was now waist level. I tried the door handle again, just in case. Definitely locked. The lights in the wall sconces flickered. Trying to do this in the dark would be a pain until I remembered my wrist brace and flicked on the torch. When the lights went out, I would be ready. I looked up and down the corridor, trying to find a solution within the rising water. Strange items floated on the surface. A hairbrush, a child's doll, but nothing I could pick a lock with. At the end stood a solid metal fire extinguisher, only to be used in case of emergency. Well, I think this counted. I hitched it off the wall and returned to the cabin. Heaving the extinguisher out of the water, I smashed it into the door. It resounded with a dull thud, but remained very much shut. "Hello, cadet. Do you..." "No, I bloody didn't. Disengage until reactivated by me." When I got home, I was going to have to ask the boffins to change the voice. This one reminded me of a paperclip I used to know. I picked up the fire extinguisher again, considered where the weakest part of the doorframe was, and smashed the metal cylinder directly against the lock. In a rush, the door gave way. I fell into the cabin as the water from the corridor surged past me, pouring into the room beyond. My ribs thumped into a table, and I ended up in a heap on the other side of the room, along with the other furniture that had washed forward in the wave of water. By the time I got to my feet, the water had leveled out and was now up to my chest. I cursed myself. I hadn't anticipated that the door would have kept out so much of the water. My entire body was shaking with the cold, but I had to get to the book. I looked around the suite. A large bed was in the far corner and water lapped at the sheets. A little writing table was on its side and a stool bobbed in the water. What had been the height of opulence less than an hour earlier was now a dishevelled mess. I pushed one of the floating chairs out of my way and headed to the far wall where the safe should be. The Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam was a collection of Persian poetry. There were many versions of it in print, but this one was known as the Great Omar. This was due to the wealth of its binding by the renowned Sangorski and Sutcliffe bookbinders. They had made the book in 1911, and it was a masterpiece. The front cover depicted three peacocks. The backboard featured a lyre. All images were made in a marquetry of various leathers and ivory and encrusted with over 1,000 gems. These emeralds, diamonds, and rubies were then set in gold, with further gold thread embroidery decorating other parts of the cover. It had taken the binders over 2 years to make, and the glorious cover was then protected in an oak slipcase. We weren't saving the contents of the book so much as its wrapping. There was a distant metallic groan as the ship twisted further. The floor was now almost at a 30-degree angle, and water was pouring in through the door. The water was deeper at this end of the room. I bobbed and swam to the far wall, wrenching the painting away from the wall safe. With shaking fingers, I removed my wrist brace and, activating its magnet, placed it against the wall of the safe and turned the dials. The brace confirmed each click. Opening the door, the surrounding water poured in and hundreds of dollar bills floated out. Grabbing a velvet bag, I shoved the Great Omar in my retrieval pouch to protect it from any damage and sagged with relief. My mission was a success. Thief! A hand grabbed my collar, and a heavy body slammed me towards the wall. My chest and shoulder hit the metal door of the safe, forcing the wind out of my lungs. I tried to duck, but the person behind me had their hand in my hair, and their other hand bunched around the neck of my shirt.
I wondered what you were doing heading away from the lifeboats, and I was right. You're nothing but a dirty little thief.
Releasing my collar, he grabbed for the book. But of course, this was a mistake. Unpinned and recovering a few seconds of breathing space, I fell in a dead weight. As I did so, I kicked out my back leg and twisted against his. The two of us fell into the water. He hadn't been expecting that, and it gave me a couple of vital seconds to turn and face him. It was the man from the corridor that had barged past me earlier. Doubtless he had got his family onto the lifeboats and then returned for his treasures. I couldn't imagine greater stupidity, although as I looked over his shoulder and saw my wrist brace stuck on the edge of the safe, I realized my stupidity outstripped his. Without my wrist brace, I was dead. I was an idiot. How could I get past him, get the brace, and get out of here? I thought I'd try the truth.
Sir, listen to me. I'm trying to save it, not steal it.
He lunged towards me with a roar. So much for trying to reason with him. He was much larger than me, but whilst he moved and fought like a street fighter, his dinner jacket suggested it had been a few years since his ill-gotten gains had elevated him from the alleyways to the opera houses. Scratch a gentleman and you'll often find dirt and corruption under your fingernails. That said, I still needed to get past him and escape. I ducked under his fist and stepped to one side. Fighting in deep water was hampering both of us, and the angle of the floor was lending him a slight advantage. Smashing a punch to his nose, I wasn't quick enough to avoid a ringing clout to the ear and slipped under the surface. Seconds later, he grabbed my hair and wrenched me upwards. I tried to pull free, but as I did, the ground under my feet shuddered. He released his grip as the ship itself tipped, and we were both suddenly swimming. The lights flickered once and then went out. I heard him shout in alarm.
Where's the door? I'll let you keep the book if you get me out of here.
I stayed silent, trying to conserve my energy. He was already lost. I didn't want to join him. The water level was rising quickly, and in the pitch dark I was blind, no longer able to tell whether it was a floor, ceiling, or wall above my head. I needed to find the safe and get my wrist brace. Swimming forward, I decided that feeling the surface in front of me, I might be able to orientate myself. The ship had stopped filling with water and was now sinking to the bottom of the ocean. Time was running out. My head hit the top. The room was now almost totally full of water. I felt above me, and my hands touched an ornate picture frame. This was the one opposite the safe, I was sure of it. The water now rose around my face, and I could feel the onset of panic. I was freezing cold and blind and knew that my life was being counted down in seconds. Taking a deep breath, I duck-dived and tried to swim down towards the safe and my wrist brace. Ahead of me, I saw the torch beam of my brace and knew it was just within reach. My throat was becoming painful and my eyes were bulging. I kicked my legs again, forcing myself down through the icy water to the brace. Every stroke was getting harder and harder. My kicks seemed weak and uncoordinated. I thought my lungs would explode, and I drew in a desperate, involuntary breath of water. 2. Julius.
And you're dead. Klaus, what did Julius do wrong?
I lay on the ground of the Hollow Suite, a large, plain white box of a room, the bright ambient lighting and warm, dry air a disorienting change. The rest of the class were sat in an adjoining room divided by a glass viewing wall. Those that weren't grinning were looking concerned, and every one of them had their hands raised. I tried to stand up, but I was still feeling slightly discombobulated by my drowning. Instead, I sat up and took large gulps of lovely dry air. Everyone died during training, but this close to graduation, deaths were rare. 6 months ago, I had unexpectedly arrived on this earth and fallen in love with an awful lot of it. What's not to love? A society based on science and academia rather than religion and commerce. Their shining achievement was the quantum technology that allowed them to open a portal to my earth and save treasures just before they became permanently lost or destroyed. Not knowing quite what to do with me as I fell through the quantum field with Neith, they had allowed me to join their final year students who were preparing to work as quantum curators. Not all would pass, but their skills would be utilized elsewhere. No one's talents were ever wasted here. Professor Hu's voice droned on as my mind drifted. He was the perfect lecturer for this class, and he had a very high pass rate. Over the years, the weaker candidates had been weeded out, moved into more suitable career paths. Early failures in academic lessons helped thin out the crowd, as had simulation scenarios. Students obviously weren't allowed to step across to the real Beta Earth and had to train in the Hollow Suites. Unsurprisingly, I was top in my class at fooling the computer algorithms into thinking I was a Beta inhabitant, which was hardly surprising, given that until 6 months ago I was. The rigors of an academic life also went in my favor. 6 months of daily exercise routines and an overhaul of my diet also meant that my general fitness and strength levels were dramatically increased. But in simulated retrieval events, I kept making stupid mistakes and dying. My fellow students now looked at me nervously. Soon one of them might be partnered with me, if I passed. I could see that they were all weighing my positive attributes against my startling ability to die. My own death would be regrettable, but they may be less sanguine about their own.
Yes, Sabrina.
Sabrina, the smartest girl in the class, or certainly the loudest and first to have her arm in the air.
Paragraph 1, subsection 1, clause 1. A quantum curator must never remove their wrist brace under any circumstance whilst on Beta Earth.
I continued to look at the ceiling. Obviously, I shouldn't have removed my brace, but what else was I supposed to do?
What should he have done instead?
He should have activated the remote listening function and focused it on the safe dial. We practiced this in years 3, 4, and 5.
You may have done, I sighed inwardly. I may not have had it drilled into me for years, but I had read the manual. I'd just forgotten that feature. There were a lot of features. I decided that if the wrist brace was so smart, it could do with a built-in help feature. Huh, see, they didn't think of everything, these alphas.
Cadet Strathclyde didn't attend those years, continued Hu. What else could he have done?
He could have interrogated the brace and ascertained which functions could help him.
Yes, well done, Sabrina.
Bravo, Sabrina, I thought sourly. Now I could go home and recuperate and maybe bang my head against a brick wall. Like I said, there were a lot of features. Too many. How annoying to have missed such a vital one.
What else did he do wrong, beyond switching off the virtual assistant? One at a time, please.
I groaned and sat back, smiling at the jury. I was happy to see them smiling back. I did like my fellow students. My hope was to become a quantum curator along with them, but first I'd have to stop dying. A voice interrupted my musings.
He shouldn't have given his jacket to the old woman. Correct.
No, I wasn't going to let that slide, and interrupted the dissection of my failings. I disagree. She was shivering.
She wasn't real.
No, sir, but none of it was, and yet we need to act as though it were. I would always give my jacket to an old woman standing in icy water, fearing for her life. But, I paused and nodded my head, next time I'll clear my pockets first.
Hmm,
who didn't sound impressed by my explanation and turned back to the class.
Any other problems?
He did spend a bit too long in the cellar. I didn't understand. Was she trying to gather intel?
Gather intel? I was standing in the cellar of the Titanic seconds before it struck the iceberg. I wanted to look around. In fairness, maybe that was a problem, but these holo simulations were just so lifelike it was utterly fascinating. I tipped my head in Camille's direction. He always delivered his assessments with manners.
Cadet Strathclyde, what exactly were you doing in there?
Asked who?
You appeared to be playing cards. Were you in fact gathering intel?
Yes, sir.
And what was the nature of that intel? Who had the Five of Hearts?
Yes, sir. The class laughed, and I smiled. I was unused to being the center of entertainment, and found I rather liked it. Or at least I liked it when they were laughing. Less so when they were staring in horror at my latest faux pas. In my defense, sir, could I say once more how incredibly impressive the Hollow Suite is, and how the mastery of your engineers is to be applauded?
You may, Cadet Strathclyde, but you also said this when you died on the Serengeti Plains, at the Mongol Uprising, and in the 17th century Doge Palace. I am concerned that you are still dying too frequently, and this fact distresses me.
I shared his concerns. I too found these death events deeply unpleasant. The rest of my squad thought it was very amusing, given how much unnecessary death there was on Beta Earth. I tried to point out we still only died the one time, and the hollow deaths were very realistic. Still, they didn't mean to be heartless. They had all done their share of dying in the hollow suite and had been smart enough to stop doing that. For the first time in my life, I was proving to be less than bright. Leaning down, Hu offered me his arm and pulled me to my feet. I stood up and left the room as Diane, the next cadet, walked in. Like me, she was barefoot and dressed in a simple lycra bodysuit from head to toe, all the better to project the hollow clothes onto. In a real-life step, we would wear genuine clothing, but for these practice events, we wore bodysuits. I was the only person who appeared to find these outfits mortifying. No one appreciates their crown jewels being molded so graphically. It was just another aspect of my new life that I couldn't get used to, their utter disregard for the human form. Nakedness was absolutely not a thing, and it had taken me weeks to try and explain what swimming trunks were and why I wanted a pair. I joined the other cadets in the viewing gallery as Diane stood motionless in the hollow suite. A Dresden sitting room rose around her as the bombs started to fall and her simulation began. "Move over," I said, as I came and sat down next to Jack and Steph. I shared most of my lessons with these two, except for the science-based ones, where I was practically in the remedial class. Steph was in the middle stream, and Jack was so bright that there were only three others in his class. I was pretty certain that Jack would make a great quantum curator, but he was here because they considered him a bit of a child genius in the science fields, and he had a particular ability in quantum maths. Hence, he was here, 17, and brimming in confidence. Steph, on the other hand, was a rock-steady pick for QC all day long. The guy was 6'5" and would have made an excellent second row. He playfully knuckled me on the head and offered to buy me a beer later, more evidence that he was a loss to rugby teams everywhere. As they shuffled along, they caused Sabrina, who had been taking notes, to tut in our direction. I whispered an apology, but she told me to be quiet. So I just grimaced at Jack and continued to watch Diane execute a perfect retrieval of a small Rembrandt. As the day wore on, no one else died, although a few failed to retrieve their specified object. One or two nearly blew it by acting incorrectly, and I winced when someone said, "Watcher, Governor," at the Royal Opera House in 1852. When Hu asked the class why this was wrong, no one put their hand up. I expected Sabrina to leap in, but she didn't know either. I was about to raise my hand when Hu called on me.
"Cadet Strathclyde, explain."
"A watcher governor is an East End form of address. It should also be pronounced differently. It would also not be employed by anyone in a dinner jacket."
"I thought that was a tuxedo,"
Sabrina chipped in. "Not in 19th century England, it's not." It didn't seem hard to me to understand the difference between British and American terminology, but I suppose I had grown up with it, and these guys weren't just learning British-American differences, they were learning the nuances of an entire world. They were incredible, and yet some of them still had an overwhelming urge to boast. Sabrina piped up again, eager to show her superior knowledge and attempt to trip me up. I always hated this moment. She was determined to show she was better than me at Beta History and Customs. I have no idea why she competed against me so aggressively, and I felt like a churl when she failed.
Sir, I think Cadet Strathclyde may be mistaken. The East End is only 3 miles from Covent Garden. It seems unlikely that the vernacular language and pronunciation would be so different.
You see, that was the problem with the Alphas. They just couldn't properly grasp class structure.
Incorrect, Cadet Mulweather, said Hu dismissively.
He didn't mind interruptions, but only when they were correct.
This is an example of societal structures and cultural dialects. Best brush up on that section before our next class. In fact, as none of you raised your hand on that point, we'll run a test on it next week. Class dismissed.
Everyone groaned except me.
Cadet Strathclyde, please stay behind.
Now it was my turn to groan.
See you down at the last bar in a bit,
said Steph, as Jack stood beside him looking concerned for me. Telling the others I'd catch them up, I waited to be bollocked in a considerate and empowering fashion. As was the way here, as was everything, it was all thoughtful, intelligent, caring, and attentive. Who'd have guessed that led to awful boredom? But equally, no famines, genocides, or pandemics. You pays your money, you takes your choice.
Look, Blue, said Professor Hu.
Inwardly I groaned. It was a terrible sign when a professor used a student's nickname. When I had first arrived, everyone kept overreacting to my name. Julius Caesar had set fire to their library block, and they were still twitchy about it. And of course, it was that one act that separated our two worlds. In my world, Julius Caesar sailed away and created the Roman Empire, and the rest, as they say, is history. In this world, his boat sank in a storm. At the same time, the Egyptian people decided that they really valued their library, and a world based on science and the betterment of humanity developed. So, they didn't like the name Julius. They tried to shorten it to Julie, but that wasn't going to happen. Only Charlie called me that, and Charlie had been killed by one of this lot. So no, they didn't get close to being able to use Charlie's words. Instead, we settled on Blue in honor of my one blue eye. My other blue eye was now residing in Neith's face. One of the charming side effects of a step gone wrong. Some splices were a lot worse. I was lucky, apparently. Incidentally, I didn't have a gaping socket where my other eye should be. That was filled with Neith's brown one. Not the most obvious of mementos, but I was beginning to get used to it. Hu continued.
We're concerned about you, for obvious reasons. You score better than your fellow students in a vast majority of fields. You turned out to be surprisingly proficient in weapons deployment, but the minute we put you anywhere interesting, you lose focus. It's basically the most important aspect of the job, and you drift off. We've been discussing it, and we think you would make an excellent lecturer, probably the best on bitter studies. Or we could offer you a post in our England.
I shuddered and quickly interrupted him. Not there, sir. They're bizarre. They keep crying and taking part in mass poetry recitals. And what's with all the televised yodeling? Hu smiled gently and continued.
Very well. But if you bow out now, that would be the sensible thing to do. We don't understand why you persist with this. An Alpha would have acknowledged their unsuitability by now. They would stop wasting resources and...
This was not going well for me. A lot of the time I felt like I was being indulged, a circus curiosity walking amongst the enlightened. And yet they were still prepared to let me try, like a lab rat. It seemed inconceivable to them that someone would waste their time and energy on such a futile course. Am I wasting resources, sir?
No, not yet. But you will be when you are on active service and fail your brief or endanger your teammate through your sudden fascination with how a lute sounds or what 12th century bread tastes like.
I broke in, keen to fight my corner. But thinking all the ways I could improve things, with the right partner, Sabrina for example. Inwardly I shuddered. They would help me focus and I would help us get to our goal with the fewest number of mistakes or misunderstandings. It was a weak argument and a selfish one. I was unlikely to bring anything special to the table. 18th century Germany was as alien to me as it was to them, but it was all I had to go on.
Very well. If you are determined to continue training, you may do so. But you have nearly reached your death quota. If you exceed that, it will be an automatic redistribution of skills and talents.
In other words, I'd be off the course and brushing down my favorite lecturer's outfit. 3. Julius. Having been dismissed, I headed to the lockers and changed into a long, cool robe, relieved to be out of my lycra bodysuit. Man's clothes were far looser here, which was understandable in the heat. We often wore long or short robes called chitons, similar to caftans. It had taken me a while to get my head around the fact that no one thought I was wearing a dress or a skirt. Finally, when I was happy that I was correctly dressed, they were fussy here about the oddest of things, I left the changing rooms. Instead of the pub, I decided to head home. I was tired and in no mood to celebrate. This world was bewildering, and just when I thought I had got a grip on it, it would slip out of my fingers. 6 months ago, they had murdered my best friend. I had been in a fight in a graveyard, held at gunpoint, and shot at. This all ended when I was dragged through into a parallel world. For obvious reasons, I'd spent the last half year trying to blend in and not draw attention to myself. Someone tried to have me killed once, and I was paranoid enough to wonder why they had stopped trying, or if indeed they had. I walked towards the central plaza and stepped out into the heat as the tinted glass doors slid open. Of all the madness that I had come to terms with in the past 6 months, it was the heat that I found hardest to reconcile. It didn't help that Egypt was now in the height of its summer. Some aspects were wonderful, as every building was beautifully air-conditioned through intelligent architecture and smart technology. Outside, the pavements and roads were coated in a membrane that absorbed heat. Microlattices ran through the substrates, wicking the heat away and converting it into energy elsewhere. Large, multicolored fabric sails billowed from the tops of buildings, offering shade and catching the tiniest of breezes. Through careful placement, they then funneled those breezes down to floor level. As the heat engulfed me, I was glad I was in a robe. I cannot begin to describe how lovely a cool breeze can be in the right location. In many ways, Alexandria felt very northern Mediterranean in temperament. I knew the Sahara was in the background, but it was a good 100 miles away and wasn't pervasive. The streets weren't sandy, there were palm and date trees everywhere, and pink bougainvillea tumbled down city walls. People were sitting out at tables, either eating and drinking or reading and writing. Some people played cards when the breeze didn't flick along the streets, and when it did, they turned to chess. On either side of these streets were the buildings of the Mauseon itself. I left the teaching block and headed home. To all intents and purposes, the city of Alexandria was the Mauseon. The archives, museums, teaching wings, the library, the conservation labs, and the quantum stepper, a giant city-sized campus. Over the centuries, Alexandria had become a global power. Whilst Cairo was very much Egypt's capital, it was Alexandria that everyone revered. The training campus for cadets was a short distance from the Mauseon itself, but I could still catch glimpses of its towers and minarets overhead. All around, the buildings were a blend of ancient, medieval, and modern. This society may have been weaker in its artistic endeavors than my own, but its engineering and architecture were awe-inspiring. Glass walkways high above my head connected red sandstone towers and minarets clad in shining blue tiles. As I watched, citizens walked across them, enjoying the breeze. I stepped out from under the shade of the atrium's canopy into full sunlight and sneezed. "Attention, citizen!" I jumped as an overhead voice hailed me, and I craned my neck to see a tete gently glide down to rest beside me. A uniformed custodian stepped out, and my shoulders slumped. "Hello, custodian Shorbaggy." Shorbaggy looked to be in his late 20s, with a solid square jaw and a crooked nose. His black hair was shaved down to his scalp, and no doubt felt good under his helmet, which was now clipped to his belt as he tapped on his wrist brace. He had the air of what I considered to be a good policeman. He was alert and attentive, but the pastel yellow uniform seemed incongruous. We had first met when I had been reported for scaring children. Apparently saying boo to children whilst being in possession of a dodgy heritage was a no-no. Within minutes, a custodian had arrived to give me a stern talking to. The custodian had introduced himself as Custodian Shorbaggy. People here were sticklers for their designations. It was all very polite and formal. For the first minute, he explained the importance of his role within society. The next minute was taken up with my role in society. He then suggested we both recite the daily affirmation together, and I pushed the sunglasses up off my face, resting them on my head. Once he had composed himself and apologized for the small cry, he said it was an honor to meet me and left. We've met each other a few times since then, and he even smiles now when he sees me, and sometimes that smile even reaches his eyes. This time his smile seemed relaxed. He was finally getting used to me.
Ah, Cadet Strathclyde. Yes, I see. May I inquire where your handkerchief is?
My hanky? I wish he hadn't asked, as I then had to listen to a lecture about the dangers of wantonly endangering humanity by spreading viruses and general bacterial lurgies. I cut him off apologizing for my grievous neglect and promised to deploy a handkerchief in all future infractions. He wasn't wrong, I just felt glum for having to be told off about something so basic. Having put his mind to rest, I asked him how his monthly quota was going and was pleased to discover that he was leading the board. Normally, the Mausean complex is considered a plum position, with lots of prestige and easy pickings from boisterous students. However, since I had arrived, it was now viewed as high risk. And how's Custodian Farag doing? Custodian Farag was Shawbaggy's arch-nemesis. Although, of course, they have no such thing as arch-nemeses, just valued teammates. Some are a little more valued than others, some a little less.
Slipped to third position. Incorrectly filed the last batch of paperwork. Used the wrong dating format, if you can believe that.
I laughed. What an idiot! Shawbaggy laughed along with me, and then remembered himself. Clearing his throat, he put his notebook back in his pocket, reminded me to purchase a handkerchief, and left with a small wave. I was beginning to have a bad influence on him. Fancy laughing about the misfortune of a valued teammate. The horror. 6 months, 185 days. Not that I was counting, but it still felt wrong as I watched his Tay-Tay rise and join the other flying traffic zipping overhead. 4. Julius. The following morning, I opened the window and smelt a change in the air. With relief, I felt that the temperature had dropped, and if I didn't know better, I could swear it was going to rain. Rainy days here were few and far between, and I loved them. Instead of an hour's study before breakfast, I slipped on my running shoes and headed out along the boardwalk. It was often full of longboarders, skaters, and other runners, but I was banking on the fact that few others would be out enjoying the rain. I knew I had miscalculated at the 7 mile mark. The rain was torrential, and whilst I didn't think I was in trouble, it would slow me down. I'd miss breakfast, and at this rate, my first lecture as well. Skipping lectures was not considered acceptable. I laughed, remembering an old girlfriend who'd found most of my life unacceptable. I wondered what she was doing now. Did she think about me? Had she even noticed I was gone? Our breakup had been somewhat abrupt, but nothing in our lives overlapped. Perhaps I'd been reported dead, although I think you have to be missing for 7 years before you can be declared legally dead. This was something that bothered me from time to time. In the early weeks, when I was trying to get my head around what had happened, I asked if my body was left behind. Was there an empty shell of me lying on King's College lawn? I had to endure a rather patronizing explanation that this wasn't astral projection, nor was I a snake that had shed its skin. I was a human being, and wherever I went, I would take my body with me. When I asked how my absence would be explained on Beta Earth, their lack of knowledge became clear, and their know-it-all attitude was replaced with a dismissive air. Those were my first introductions to the Alpha attitude towards the Beta Earth. Parental at best, derogatory at worst. When I tried to ask again what it meant if I just disappeared, they said that people in my world disappear all the time and no one seems to care. Why did I think I would be any different? I have to confess that stung. Maybe people would assume I'd been bumped off in an attempt to grab the priceless Faberge egg. Neith said they had placed a large cash deposit in my bank account to apologize for all the inconvenience. It was standard procedure, but of course she had done that before the showdown on the college lawn when I was yanked through to this world. Maybe the police would find the money and decide it lent greater weight to the fact that I had been done away with, especially as no one was spending the money. There hadn't been a live event in the past 6 months, so there was no way for me to return or even to ask someone to drop off a postcard to my folks. A live event was when the quantum stepper calibrated a precious item becoming available in real time. Our worlds ran on the same timeline, so if it was Wednesday here, it was Wednesday there. Generally, the stepper opened into moments in the past, but occasionally, once or twice a year, it opened in real time. It was the rain that made me think of home and my state of existence, so, like I said, maybe I was dead. I pushed my wet hair back off my face and turned to face the onslaught, and was caught out by just how much water there was in the air. I know we Brits like to go on about the rain, but this was monsoon-like. Yes, with this wind I was definitely going to be late. I'd have to go back to my dorm to change, grab some fruit to last me until lunch, and then spend my lunchtime trying to catch up on the first lesson. Thank God it was early European faith-based systems, a lesson I could probably deliver myself. The problem was that my lecturer might think the same thing and assume that's why I'd skipped his class. That would be unforgivably rude of me. I upped my pace and decided I would run straight to the lecture. They might laugh at the foolish beater arriving dripping wet, but at least my lecturer would know I wasn't slighting him. A car overtook me, and its brake lights shone through the spray from the road. The rain was so heavy now that the rest of the car was barely visible. It made a U-turn, passed me on the other side of the road, and a few moments later pulled up alongside me and the window lowered. I jogged over and saw with dismay it was Chancellor Soliman Alvarez.
"Hurry up, man, get in the car, you're letting in all the rain."
I thought that was a little unfair, but I could hardly debate the point, and got in, my wet clothes sliding on his expensive leather upholstery.
"What on earth are you doing out in this?"
He smiled at me with an avuncular air, and then returned his attention to the road ahead. The force of the rain was making a mockery of his wipers, and the road was filling with surface water.
"I just felt like a run in the rain,"
I panted with an apologetic laugh, and wiped my face.
"Didn't realize it was going to get this bad." "Ah, yes," he said. "What is your saying? A mad dog's an Englishman."
He laughed at his own joke, and I refrained from pointing out the lack of a midday sun.
"Tell you what, why don't we get you back to your dorm? You can get changed and then join me for breakfast."
Inwardly, I groaned. Since I had arrived, I supposed I was one of the Chancellor's pet projects. I didn't know if he found me a curiosity or a threat to his establishment, but he would regularly invite me out for a meal or a coffee and a chat. Once a month, he invited me to a poetry recital, which was possibly the most excruciating thing I have ever endured, and I have sat through an entire production of the Ambleforth W.I.'s Mikado. Having watched Solomon declaim on Ovid and football, I decided to apologize to the Women's Institute. Happily, though, I had a perfect excuse to turn him down and explained I had lectures first thing.
"What have you got this morning?"
"Religious studies."
"Ah, with old Peepy. I bet you know more than he does."
He laughed a little cruelly and slapped the steering wheel. I rather liked Pierre Rigaud, and we often shared a drink in the bar. I was fascinated by his culture's belief systems, which he tried to insist were few and far between, and he loved to hear more about mine. It was always an enjoyable evening. He had an inquiring mind that was ready to acknowledge a point if well argued. He was also happy to defend a principle to the last of his breath.
"That's as it may be, sir, but still it would reflect poorly on everyone if I failed to attend a lecture, no matter how..."
I paused, trying to think of a suitable adjective. "Turgid? Dreary? Asinine?" "Interesting, the alternative." He beamed at me.
"Good call. You know I wasn't sure about you when you first arrived, but you are definitely one of us, aren't you? I like the cut of your jib."
Where did he get his language from? It was as though he had been raised on a diet of Biggles and Shelley. Rami had told me that some people were total beta-files and had little cliques within that. The Chancellor appeared to be a fan of late colonial England. What-what, toodle-pip and tally-ho. I smiled weakly and insisted that I couldn't miss my first lecture. I checked my wrist brace. Given this lift, I could get changed and make it to the lecture on time.
"Tell you what, I'll come with you. Get changed and then we can arrive together. If you're late, I can say it was my fault. I need to speak to old Peepy anyway."
I thanked him as sincerely as I could, which he seemed to accept. And 30 minutes later, we hurried in through the plaza to the lecture hall. I had made it just in time, although I noticed that the room was only half full and others like me had wet hair. Some who didn't live on campus were looking decidedly soggy. Others were slipping off their sandals and wringing out the base of their trousers or caftans by the front door. As each one rushed in, they all had a uniformly alarmed expression as they noticed their chancellor sitting on the edge of a table, giving them jovial smiles. Now and then he'd offer a little quip about how a well-prepared curator would not arrive wet or late, reminding them that a good curator is a prepared curator. I stood beside him, cringing. I wanted to join the others, but he kept asking me questions, and it was clear that he wanted everyone to witness this favoritism. A door banged from the other side of the lecture hall, and Professor Rigaud arrived, heralded by a gust of wind. He smiled at his class, laughing at the drama, and then his face fell as Chancellor Alvarez's voice boomed across the lecture floor.
Pierre, dear boy, how good of you to join us. I was just telling your young charges here how important it is to be prepared.
Well, yes, this is quite the squall, isn't it? I apologize for being late.
No matter, no matter. I have no doubt young Strathclyde here could have taken the lecture himself and probably a lot better. Yes?
He boomed with laughter, making everyone feel desperately uncomfortable. Or maybe that was just me. Still, no one else laughed. If you'll excuse me, sir, I said to the Chancellor, I'll just go and take my seat, but thank you for the lift.
Any time, dear boy, any time,
he said in a voice that carried to the back of the theatre.
Let's do lunch. Okay, Pip-Pip. Pierre, I will catch up with you later. I wouldn't want to delay your class any further. Besides which, I'm meeting the Pharaoh in a minute. He needs my advice on a few matters of state.
With that, he quit the lecture hall and left behind a general air of awkwardness. The lecture was an enjoyable discussion of the Christmas customs, and whilst Rigaud and I generally cantered back and forth with the rest of the students jumping in with questions, my heart wasn't in it today. I felt I had been used to somehow belittle him, and I felt uncomfortable. It was a double session with a halfway coffee break, and I'd stood up to try and grab a drink and some breakfast when Rigaud came over.
Are you okay? You seem quiet today.
This morning I didn't want you to get the impression that I thought I could do your job better than you. Pierre Rigaud rolled his eyes.
Of course you could, or you certainly could for parts of it. It would be the act of a fool to think otherwise, and it would be the act of an even greater fool if he thought he could use a student against me to try to belittle me.
He arched his eyebrows and then smiled.
Go grab a coffee, and when we get back, I want you to explain why you eat coal at Christmas.
The coffee here was delicious, and I was about to take a sip when Sabrina came over. It was a girl that would never miss an opportunity to advance herself.
Why did the Chancellor give you a lift in? You live here in halls.
I was out running and got called short by...
Fine.
She cut across me.
Don't tell me then. I just wasn't aware you and the Chancellor were on such good terms.
I couldn't tell if she was offended or appalled, but she obviously didn't believe anyone would run in a monsoon, at least not voluntarily. Honestly, we aren't on good terms. I barely know him. I was just out running and he saved my bacon.
You had breakfast together?
She asked, confused by my expression. No, it's just a saying. I regretted it as soon as I had said it, as she tapped on her wrist brace. They love storing up idioms.
To save another person's bacon. This is a beta saying that means...
She looked up inquiringly. It means he got me out of a sticky wicket.
Sticky wicket?
I sighed. My coffee was going cold, and I still hadn't grabbed any sort of breakfast, real or metaphorical. He helped me out of a difficult situation. I would have been late without his assistance. She repeated what I had said into her wrist brace and then looked up at me again.
And what is a wicket and why is it sticky?
I glumly explained as I sipped at my coffee and thought about lunch instead. The second half of the lecture was much more fun as the students pitched in with questions from their studies. We were having a great time until I mentioned that in Beta England we had once banned Christmas carols during the interregnum. The class suddenly looked awkwardly at the floor or the ceiling or anywhere but me. Did I miss something? I asked. Is this one of those you know something and I don't moments?
Have you looked through your temporal anomalies textbook? Said Rigaud apologetically.
As we broke for lunch, my mood was much improved, and Rigaud asked me how my projects were coming along. As well as an end-of-year exam, each subject had a project to complete. Over the past 6 months, I had been taking end-of-year exams every month. I was only covering the basics each time, but it meant my workload was enormous. I was now theoretically on the same level as the others, although there were still gaping holes. One area of study I was enjoying, though, was the final year project, as it meant I had time to do research rather than pure revision. I was doing a piece on the Romans and their lack of dominance. The division point between our two worlds fascinated me, and I wanted to explore it as closely as I could. Interestingly, the people of this earth were far less interested in the Romans than I was. However, I had run into a curious issue with dialing up exhibits. Actually, you may be able to help me with that. I was trying to look up an exhibit and Tiresias directed me to the level 5 vaults, but I don't have permission for that. The professor looked at me and cocked his head.
Why ever are you bothering with the originals? Pull up a holo.
That's the issue. Apparently there isn't one. That caught his attention, and he beamed at me, full of eager curiosity.
"Whatever are you trying to view?"
"Some Roman artefacts." His face fell into polite disinterest.
Oh well, yes, I suppose there is a limit to what is copied. Still, if you are interested in them...
He broke off and tapped on the screen on his lectern.
"There you are. Access granted."
I thanked him and headed off to the archives. At this rate, I wouldn't be eating until supper.
5. Nagger. Nagger O'Reilly looked around the room for a final check. Each place had pens and paper. The Chancellor liked a secure method of data storage. At the end of any meeting, he would either put his notes in his briefcase or insist they were incinerated in front of him. Nagger mentally added a note to switch off the fire alarms. Chancellor Solomon Alvarez was hosting today's meeting, and as his assistant, it was Nagger's job to ensure everything was perfect. Especially as today, he wouldn't be the most important person at the table. Far from it. Today was the annual quantum review, and all the senior figures from Egypt would be present, as well as representatives of other international mausoleums. The seating plan had been a nightmare. All 40 viziers had naturally been invited, but not all were active or interested, so they had seats around the outer edge of the room where they could watch or take part or fall asleep. Then Nagger had to balance all the other functionaries. Chancellor Alvarez, as host, sat in the middle of the table. Opposite him sat Pharaoh Tarek. The current pharaoh was coming to an end of his 10-year term, and as no one could be pharaoh more than once, a new face would soon govern Egypt. Seating the pharaoh, the viziers, and her chancellor had been easy. It was fitting in the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.